If music wakes you up, makes you think, heals you, I guess the music is working.
And the Oscar goes to A R Rahman.
I can say as a composer myself is that he's the most extraordinary melody writer, but he writes melodies in a way that a Western composer can't.
He's working in a medium that is so full of pleasure and drive, especially movie music, you know. And of course, he comes partly out of a pop music, pop jingle sensibility, which is all about selling and appeal and kind of all that kind of stuff. And yet, there's another side of him which is very meditative, you know, and very spiritual.
Whether it was Mozart, or whether it was the Beatles, or whether it was R.D. Burman, whether it's A.R. Rahman, they have an intuitive idea of what will appeal to you.
I'm a bit jet-lagged, otherwise I would love to come and hug you all. I'll do that very soon.
The show is the merging of modern cutting-edge technology with traditional India without losing the true essence and soul of the country.
AR.
He's very meticulous by nature. He likes to get things done right, whether it's in the studio or live, and he carries that to his live shows as well. He's very critical of his own work, so he really prepares himself, especially his own material.
इश्क बिना क्या जीना यारो बोलना इश्क बिना क्या जीना
He has become more conscious because of the international recognition, conscious to the fact that every little detail of what goes out is important and it will somewhere or the other affect his image.
Check my baby on a Saturday.
When you see him today, there's a huge transition between what his first performance was and what is today.
He has progressed. As a person, he has grown, which is a mark of a genius, I would say. You know, the whole personality changes, the assimilation.
coming to Los Angeles or having this other alternate option sometimes to get away sometimes gives me a freedom, which I can keep walking on the road. I can go to a library, I can go to a music shop, I can go to a restaurant, and yet be myself and alone. And that gives me time to sometimes study humanity, be in touch. Because if you're not in touch with what's the reality, you suffer from certain things artistically also.
No one's actually listening, don't worry.
Is that Pacey?
No, no.
This would be awesome if I lived.
Yeah, that's why you should have.
Ladies and gentlemen, please open your doors. Thank you and have a wonderful evening. Thank you.
I got a call suddenly from Shekhar saying, AR. And I said, what? Andrew Lloyd Webber wants to talk to you. I thought it was a joke. And then suddenly I hear this British voice, would you be interested in doing this? kind of thing. And so I was a bit taken aback. And because I was doing 12, 13 movies back in India.
I wanted to produce him here because I just was such a fan of his music.
But it's all the fact that you don't change the harmony in there, which is what's so clever. And it's all those lines you write on the strings and all the string synths.
Rahman was quite unwilling, actually, to go to the West first.
It was dangerous because if something had gone wrong, I would have, again, had to come back and people would have said, ah, okay, what happened?
I think he wasn't sure that they would accept him. He wasn't sure that in going to the West, he would not drop his fan base. Would his fan base in India reject him and then goes to another place? I'm a bit of an adventurer, so someone managed to convince him to come, and then he came in. The rest is history.
I live around this area. Nothing much has changed for the past 20, 25 years. Of course, there's a new airport, beautiful airport. There's internet, there's TV, but everything seems the same. Same posters, clutter. But beautiful people. And lovely restaurants.
My father was a music director. He was an assistant music director for 12 popular music directors of Kerala.
எங்களுக்கு ஒரு ஆம்பளை குழந்தை பார்த்தோன்னு ரொம்ப சந்தோஷப்பட்டாங்க அவங்க அப்பா எல்லாம் அவங்க அப்பா வாசிக்கிறப்ப அதையே வாசிக்கிறது அப்புறம் அதே டியூனை மாத்துறது வெளியே மாத்திடுவாரு ஹார்மோனியத்துல அவங்க அப்பா அங்கே நேர்ந்து வந்து பார்ப்பாரு என்ன இது நம்ம டியூனே வேற மாதிரி அதே டியூன்ல மியூசிக் அவர் போடுவார் அப்படி ஒரு குழந்தைலதான் ஞானம் கடவுளுடையது
ஏஆர் And me, we just grown up like. Good job. When I saw AR, he was just playing at home, very young boy. And I asked to call him, come and practice with me. And he's very shy and he's a little bit, no.
I was in the fourth standard or something, and one of the teachers came and said that, whispered in another teacher's ear, and they said, you have to go home. we're all very too young to even realize. But I can still remember cremating him, setting him on fire. I was as young as 9, and so that's one imagery which, some imagery in your life never goes off. It was 3 dark, you know, funeral places where people cremate with sticks and things, and unforgettable.
அவங்க அப்பா இறந்த உடனே அந்த காம்போலாம் கொண்டு வந்திருந்தார் சிங்கப்பூர்லேருந்து. அப்போ என் பையன் வாசலாக தான் எங்களுக்கு ஒர்க்கு நடக்கும். ஸ்டுடியோவில் போயிட்டு வாசிக்கணும் இல்லை செட் பண்ணணும். அப்போ யாருக்குமே எங்க தெரியாது. இவர் தான் போய் செட் பண்ணி கொடுப்பாரு எல்லாருக்கும்.
Even though he was not very good at studies and he wanted to go to school, but my mother insisted that he goes and plays because she needed the money to run the family. So that was a very, heart-crunching situation.
It was a very steep decision where I was half-heartedly leaving high school campus and say that, what's going to happen to me? Mostly what I learned from music or education is all from life, actually. I learned a bit of music, I learned a bit of, you know, did schooling, but what I learned, the most important things was discovered by me in the journey of life. All those equipments which my father had kept were very costly keyboards. And then when I went deep into it, I discovered that the interest in science which I had and music both culminated in what was happening with MIDI and many things which came and synthesizers, which later I got so passionate about. And that's the foundation of what I'm doing now.
At that time, I began doing advertising commercials. I first pulled out Rahman from Dilip from Chennai and went for a first recording. He traveled to do a commercial for me in Mumbai.
Sleek.
From a keyboard player to a composer, I think it was a very important phase. And it was a completely new world for me. The way they would think, the way they would speak, and the influences and the references. And so it was almost, like I would say, a giant leap in my sensibilities. So this is one of the first pieces of equipment I bought for my studio. And it's a Fostex mixer. Fostex 16 track recorder. Most of the early 90s music was recorded on this and mixed. We don't use it anymore, but we use it just like a museum.
I met him at a common friend's party. And we were sitting and chatting.
I told him, why don't you come to my studio and check out? And he looked at me, maybe. And I didn't even know that he's really going to come in 6 months. And 6 months later, he came and he said, play me all your stuff. And that's just history.
When I went to his studio, that itself was a drastic change in the sense that they hear there is this young kid who has come and who has converted his car shed into one studio. And he was producing the most amazing sound from that place. It came at a time when, you know, maybe the rest of the music was, you know, was kind of heavy. A lot of clutter was there, a lot of instruments was there. So his music in the early stages were sparse. You know, it had a lot of breathing. It had a lot of air and a lot of space for it to exist.
First, I heard the music at home. Why are you doing it? First, I record it.
I phoned up Mr. Maniratnam and told Maniratnam, it's a very happy occasion. The song is excellent. It is going to be a song of the decade. But it happens to be a song of many decades.
Initially, what made Rahman, his brilliance of sound, he brought a new sound. And at that time, music was sounding different, but orchestration was sounding different in films. But he brought up the change. Rukmani, Rukmani,
akambaka, enna sattam. Rahman's huge strength is rhythm, you know. I mean, he's born with rhythm in his, you know, in his mind, I think.
It was a giant leap, for me at least. And then I didn't know whether people would accept that. I don't know whether they'd throw it on my face. I think at that point of time in my life, I was going through a very a mental transformation. Almost like surrendering.
My father died, like, she used to go to the dargah, she used to go to the temples, and she used to go to the church everywhere, my mother. She was trying to see who's the real God, kind of. So that was the time that Peer Sahib, he knew that she was open-minded, and he started telling about Islam.
என்னப்பா நீங்க இது இதை கும்பிட பொரியா இருக்கும் எனக்கு இஸ்லாம் தம்மா வேணும்னு
எனி ஃபேமிலி ஹூ கோஸ் த்ரூ பெயின் இன் லைஃப் யூ ஆர் ஆல்வேஸ் கான்ஸ்டன்ட்லி லுக்கிங் அட் யூ நோ த லைட் அட் த எண்ட் ஆஃப் த டனல் Because we had the right guide, we could feel the sense of spirituality. And that's what moved us from one faith to another faith. I was in a very Sufi kind of a vibration where I was learning things about spirituality and how nothing counts, nothing matters, and it still matters. So it's a dichotomy of having something and not having something. Whether it's success or fame or money or, you know, it's about having this eternal happiness within you and not reacting to momentary, you know, senses. But music is about senses again. Again, there's a dichotomy there.
So there was something about, let's say, Bombay, where he seemed to go from Western to Indian and back to Western, classical into Indian, so effortlessly.
It was also breaking the mold of just doing songs. And having a tune which is so lyrical that you wouldn't need lyrics.
A kind of a music which will challenge me as a director to reinterpret song picturizations. When I described how I want to shoot it and everything, he came up with this tune which he sent me on a bare track, you know. I thought he's gone mad. Mistake, I thought he sent me something else, some classical Carnatic raga or whatever. I said, Rahman, I told you about the erotic, you sent me something. No, this is made for the same situation. I said, that situation, how can this tune? I just couldn't understand.
What I had to do was have the tune more snappier in the same grid of the rag and give it that little energy underneath.
Then he did the orchestration and it blew me away.
Sometimes I do a song for, not like literally every day, I work on it and come back to it after a week. So when I come back to it after a week, I notice certain things and change certain things. And then again, I go back to 2 weeks later and certain things are changed. So like this, what happens is all the changes are unpredictable, but it adds to that very subtly.
Most people's first reaction to Rahman's music is because it is so unexpected. Half in your mind, you'll expect it to sound like another hit song you heard, okay, in the genre. The moment it doesn't sound like that, I think you get disoriented.
Every time his new music comes up, the first thing is everybody says, oh, well, this is not really Rahman, you know, this one won't succeed. 1 month later, it's the top of the charts. 1 year later, people are still listening to it. What was it that appeals to you? It's indescribable. It's like being in love. How do you explain it?
When Rangila released, it was also the time when I got married. So it was a whole new experience. Marriage, I think it was exciting and terrifying, both. Your whole loyalty towards family is split in a way, because it's you and a wife, and then it's your mother. Some cultural differences were there, but on the whole, I think that was the biggest challenges of my life, to face that. In fact, that expanded my whole sensibilities of compassion and understanding, patience, many things, which then transformed into a larger perspective. My kids keep asking sometimes, you know, you're not, Daddy, you just keep going out. So you need to spend time with us. And I do spend time with them. I keep telling them, at least you have a dad. I didn't have a dad. So you should be happy about it. Your dad keeps traveling, that's it. He comes back. My dad never came back. We always have to see what we are blessed with and not what we are denied. And that's what I teach my kids. For me, it was very pure intention to give something people very pure from my, you know, my studio, my heart.
In 97, when this was recorded, it was a new sound itself. But true to whether you listen to Michael Jackson or any of the great musicians and even Rahman, certain sounds they create is timeless. Even though it's contemporary for the time, they are timeless. Vande Mataram is one such composition of Rahman, which today, it's 15 years now, it's still fresh and rocking.
But what he managed to do is fuse the idea of composition, in fact, fuse the idea of rag, and fuse them with the kind of production, modern virtual sounds, computerized sounds, productions, and fuse them with those traditional ideas of composition. No, Chaiya Chaiya is an international rock number. And, you know, Rahman later on went on to form a little group with Dave Stewart and Mick Jagger. And Dave Stewart also said, this guy is quite incredible. He's rock and he's classical all at the same time.
वो क्या करता है कि इतना स्लो गाना शुरू करता है कि आपको लगता है कि आप लेट जाएंगे आपने कभी भी देखा होगा उसकी कंपोजिशन में तो पहले वो बहुत ही प्यार से इस बात शुरू करेगा है ना एकदम वो दोस्त से अटैक करेगा उसके गाने पिक्चराइज करने के लिए जस्टिफाई रहमान साउंड आई हैड टू लिसन हिज सॉन्ग फॉर 200 टाइम्स इन माय हाउस इन माय कार एवरीवेयर देन आई विल गेट द होल वाइब्रेशन ऑफ हिज साउंड एंड अंडरस्टैंड द होल थिंग एंड दिस हाउ आई विल कंपोज ईच शॉट नाउ ही अंडरस्टैंड्स हिंदी बट दैट टाइम ही डिड नॉट अंडरस्टैंड हिंदी सो आई हैड टू राइट एवरी वर्ड Translate every word in English. Then I had to express the subcontext of the poetry, the situation to him.
By his advice, I literally started learning Hindi more and started reading more couplets and poems and Urdu and all these things happened. And then my passion towards Punjabi started. And listening to Nusrat Fateh Ali Khan, of course, was also another major influence.
We were composing Taal. We spent more than 69 nights together to compose 7 songs.
It's never a cakewalk with Rahman. You have to travel the path with him. You have to be willing to push him, ask him for more, not be afraid to tell him that we can do something else, no? And having done that, having asked that, you have to have the patience to wait for that something else to happen. So you should be able to afford that with him. That's a tough trek. And you do that trek, at the end of it, it is satisfying.
He annoys me a lot about this. Suddenly, we have a chess tune. We have a bathroom. That way, he's very unpredictable.
When I miss prayers, I feel like I'm losing it. My temper, I lose sometimes. And my whole balance of my mental and physical state of body changes in a very bad way. So I'm forced to not break the cycle in a way, and forced not to engage in any or drinking or smoking or fornicating because my next prayer is almost ready for in the next couple of hours or 3-4 hours.
So, har artist mein kuch na kuch trick to hongi aisi jo thodi si irritating bhi hongi. Mera to kabhi gussa bhi aa jata hai uske upar. Main kabhi lad bhi padta hu uske upar ki kuch to discipline rakho. Lekin fir main sochta hu ki shayad artist discipline na hi rakhe to better hai, because when he gives you such a beautiful compositions to aap uski sab galtiyan maaf kar dete hain.
I had met somebody who I really, really believe could carry the torch of musical theatre into a completely different dimension. So at this point, I must introduce you to the composer of Bombay Dreams.
I didn't know a thing what was happening. What I was enjoying this ride because it was unconventional, and I'm going into another dangerous zone.
Good luck, which is a tradition to break a coconut.
One day I found Andrew Lloyd Webber pacing up and down outside his studio. So I said, "What's the matter?" He said, "This man has turned my studio into a mosque."
Running.
And I said, "Why? What's the problem?" He said, "I'm not allowed in without my shoes on. There's incense everywhere. You know, he's kneeling down." And so, you know, it was quite a clash of cultures. Andrew Lloyd Webber couldn't understand why he, in his own studio, would not be allowed in with his shoes on. Saw your face and the damage was done.
You weaved a spell that took me over. He's unique. I don't know of any other composer who's really like him. I mean, either Indian or Western. Catch the rhythm, jump to the beat. The nights are warm and my words are tender. He thinks in a very, very definite way. You can always tell, which is the highest compliment you can pay to anybody. You can always tell one of his songs.
I didn't know that these 4 years or 3 years of Bombay Dreams could change so much of my sensibilities, which is almost a foundation for my next 10 years.
Worked very, very well in London. On Broadway, it didn't. And I think that we were really ahead of our time. And I think it struck me as extraordinary that the American critics simply did not get the music at all. I mean, it just was something which went over their heads. And I remember actually saying to one of them, you know, you're going to live to regret this. And then, of course, 5 or 6 years' time, you know, well, later than that onwards, of course, he wins 2 Oscars, and that's the answer to the point, isn't it?
The feeling of the approaching clouds. And I did not want to do it through just thunder, you know, sounds of thunder and effects. Rahman kept trying it. It took him about 2-3 days, and nothing was working right. One morning at about 5 a.m. at dawn, he called me and said, I think I've got it. He took the word Ghanan Ghanan, and he looped it several times, and then gave it highs and lows. So it became Ghanan Ghanan.
Rahman is one of those people who have changed things. And he has given a kind of new sensibility to Indian music listener and the music makers vis-a-vis the sound, the orchestration, the structure of the song. He has challenged the basic structure of Indian film song.
When we were doing the songs of Lagan, Javed Akhtar ji was, at that time he said ki, are bhai ye kahan se shuru hota hai, kahan chala jata hai? उसको बोलना पड़ता है कि भैया वापस आ जाओ अब बहुत हो गया वापस आ जाओ मेघा छाए बरखा लाए गिर गिर आए गिर के आए because the song used to just you know just go various directions going up going down and we used to wonder ki isme music kahan aayega aur how is the song going to come back to the mukhra gaye din badal tu ghar se nikal barasne wala ab humne reet jal
एक मुखड़ा है मुखड़े के बाद फिर म्यूजिक आता है फिर अंतरा आ जाता है अंतरे के बाद एक क्रॉस लाइन आती है शुरू से गीत इसी शक्ल में लिखे जाते थे और रहमान ने वो तोड़ दिया हुआ छटा खुदा गगन मेरा नई डगर नया सफर मेरा जो बन सके तू हम सफर मेरा वो होराइजन स्थाई का लौट के कहां पर आएगा वो पता नहीं आंधियों से झगड़ रही है लौ मेरी अब मशालों से बढ़ रही है लौ मेरी जिस तरह क्लासिकल सिंगिंग या सेमी क्लासिकल में विस्तार करते हैं वो धुन को उस तरह से विस्तार करता है और वो एक से एक लिंक होते हुए बढ़ते चली जाती है रहे ना रहे ये रहे ना रहे तो मेरे लिए ये बड़ा खूबसूरत अंदाज था क्योंकि ब्लैंक वर्स के करीब आ जाती है ये नज्म के करीब आ गया है ये गाने की शक्ल ये सबसे बड़ी कंट्रीब्यूशन है रहमान की रोशन हुआ जी गया क्यों सहते रहे रूबरू
रोशनी When the pattern becomes predictable, the song becomes predictable and then becomes a bit boring. And sometimes the song, what drives the song is not the mukhada or antra, but the chorus. Sometimes what drives the song is a mukhada. Sometimes what drives the song is probably a hook line. When you understand what drives the song and why it should become a hit, how you had to project it, you don't have to stick with the formulas.
इसके अलावा के शक्ल और ढांचा और फॉर्म गाने की बदली, उसके अलावा मौजू बदला, कंटेंट में सूफियाना गाने ऐसे नहीं कि उससे पहले थे नहीं, लेकिन सूफियाना एक दौर की तरह से जो पैदा हुआ वो रहमान के यहाँ हुआ। गलतफहमी भी आजकल किसी भी गाने को सूफियाना बोल देते हैं, वो सिर्फ मौला लगा देने से सॉफ्ट सूफियाना नहीं हो जाता, लेकिन वो जो कंटेंट और उसका जो मवाद है, इल्हामी अंदाज है रहमान के अंदर, इसलिए है वो कोई पहना हुआ, ऊपर से पहना हुआ नहीं है, उसके अंदर की आवाज है। ख्वाजा मेरे ख्वाजा, दिल में समा जा, शाह का शाहू,
अली का दुलारा। The change in my life came when I started visiting, you know, Sufi shrines. My mind would open up and I would start thinking in a way which is not conventional. Because the conventional way of thinking is, okay, I have to do this right and then it'll become successful and then it'll... But then that's not the story of life. Life is always unpredictable. And many, many good things happen to you even without you expecting. Many bad things happen to you without you expecting. And what, who controls all this stuff? And music, in a way, is the same thing for me. Sometimes I feel I know how to do a song, and when I do it, it's all wrong. So every time I do a song, I feel like, when I feel I think I know how to do the song, I know that I'm wrong. And so I take the other step, I just keep quiet, and I'll wait for it to come naturally in a way which would be what would be right for the song. And for this, what would we call this? This approach is very unradical approach, I would say, but a spiritual approach towards music. our do music changed. And the spontaneity which I had with even orchestrations had to change. And I worked with many symphony orchestras, Birmingham Symphony Orchestra, Washington, LA Philharmonic, and now Babelsberg Orchestra.
Orchestra, can you hear me? How is the volume of the click?
Okay.
I'll go to therapy after this and deal with it. Ah, they laughed, thank goodness.
Traveling and seeing music everywhere and going back to my own place made me think it's so easy for me now, you know, to build this bridge between the knowledge which we don't have and the knowledge which we have. We're teaching almost around 50, 60 kids string section, which we don't have. We're getting underprivileged kids and teaching music.
We have adopted a school here, like where we give them free coaching. Like every day they come in the morning at 7 o'clock until 9 o'clock, and then again in the evening they come at 4 o'clock. Inshallah, by God's grace, in another 5 or 6 years, we might be able to achieve Mr. Rahman's dream to create a symphony orchestra.
Why can't an Indian village boy play Beethoven, and why can't a 12-year-old boy from New York, a Jewish boy, play the sitar, you know, and play the Indian rag? So he wants to fuse and put together the world together through music. He wants to create one world through music.
Then there was the question is who was going to do the music. And I have to give credit to the guys that we were working with who kept saying to me all the time, you've got to use Rahman. You've got to use A R Rahman.
There are some bits and pieces that we haven't really touched yet, but I'm imagining they'll come out of the main themes, really.
We also need to know about the budget, so
budget,
you don't want to go overspend at the same time.
Yeah.
all musicians are the same. They don't really start working until the sun's gone down, you know? And then they begin to work. And it's exhausting because they work through the middle of the night. So we'd be sat there and they'd have all these people turning up from the West End, and all these musicians, singers, performers. They'd all turn up for him at 11 o'clock at night.
Almost everything in slow motion.
Okay. Like all great musicians, he doesn't do what you tell him, because he'd be rubbish if you did, but he interprets it.
The thing about that movie was it had only 18 or 19 cues. Normally in a movie, you would have like 153, 154 cues in so many reels. So it never even occurred to me that the impact of this music would be so much.
I love the thing he did at the beginning, Osaya, with MIA, because it was very important to start the film in a way that was like rampant. There was going to be no opportunity for people to back away from this film. You know, it was like, woof, straight at you.
They had already shot the song with Aaj Ki Raat. Song from another movie doesn't qualify for anything. And it doesn't seem right because Indian audiences have already heard the song. So a new song would be good. So then this song, Jai Ho, was done and time stretched to the exact beats per minute.
All of us sat back and said, oh boy, if that's how the world reacts to Jai Ho, let them hear the rest of Rahman. With Jai Ho, he became a bit of a pop icon. And that, of course, cuts, the moment you become a pop icon, you cut across all cultures and all barriers. And so no longer are you niche. And that's what he managed to do. And he has the ability to do that, and that's what makes him very popular.
I think music, when it's connected to your soul, and when it's really, really important, there is something which happens.
But his score for the film is phenomenal, I think. I mean, they gave him those Oscars because he's serious. They don't give out Oscars easily in the composition world. That's why it tends to be all the same guys getting it all the time. They don't let newcomers in very easily.
I remember calling him saying, Rahman, don't be disappointed they don't give it to you. Because there are other things that, not just the music, there's so many other forces at play.
But I think they all knew that this was like, this wasn't just a one-song film. This was seriously scored throughout. I don't think there are any boundaries in his music. I think there are in people listening to it sometimes, but that's just them, you know. But there's no boundaries in him at all.
How much do you love music?
Tremendously. I wouldn't have been here otherwise.
Okay, do you love me?
Do you want me to say that? Do you want me to show that?
Well, I think, you know, he's one of the most extraordinary melodists, you know, of the 20th, 21st centuries. The way he's taken his music and the way he's managed to make something which is very definitely his own puts him right up there with, you know, the great melodists of all time. I mean, the McCartneys, the Richard Rodgerses, the Gershwins and all of that. I think he will be remembered in 30, 40 years' time as somebody right up there with all of those.
This is by Albert Einstein. He said, everything is determined, the beginning as well as the end, by forces over which we have no control. It is determined for the insect as well as the star, human beings, vegetables, or cosmic dust. We all dance to a mysterious tune, intoned in the distance by an invisible piper. None of us know who that invisible piper is. Some of us think we do, but nobody really knows who the invisible piper is. But the song that he's playing will be written by A R Rahman.
If my music connects with an American or an Arab or an Indian or a Pakistani or a Bangladeshi or a South Indian, North Indian, it's all because of the intention where I feel it's unconditional giving and somewhere hard-rooted and gravitational towards purity and love.
Oh, my whole day is gone into this. I'm gonna feel naked.